You say a word about Joe?
Joe, you know, I knew Joe since my father used to go up to the White, when he had his grocery store on Rantoul Street, he used to go up to White Birch Farm and take me with him when I was, you know, just barely old enough to remember, and buy vegetables there and all that. And they used to come do trade with my father too in his store. And then sometimes I'd be left to play with Joe and all that for a few hours and things like that. So I knew Joe most of my life. And then Joe was always basically, believe it or not, he was a quiet type. He was basically a quiet guy. He was a guy that everyone liked all the time. He was always strong and husky, developed his muscles working on that farm. And he was in my class in school throughout the junior high school and the high school. And he left, I believe it was in 1946, he enlisted in the Marines and did a hitch. And then he came out, and you probably know that he went back in again.
Yeah. I also know that Charlie Walsh wanted to play football at Berkeley High School.
Right. But he had the same problem I did. I went out for football. Joe went out for football. But God bless our fathers, both of them. We had fathers that needed us. Okay, he was needed on the farm, and I was needed in the store. And I think that's one of the private relationships that Joe and I had between each other. We understood each other because we both were sort of frustrated. We had a couldn't get involved in some of the activities that the other kids were. Yeah. Nothing against our families, but tends to rob a kid of some of his youth when you have
And that was fairly common in those days.
It was very common in those days.
You know, you didn't get a chance to enjoy life at the school level as the kids do today, out of necessity. So Joe went back for the second hitch, and that's when he was over
that's
in
when he
ended Korea in 51.
He went in there specifically because he wanted to get to Korea.
Yeah. Okay. So. Richard?
Yeah, we just, of course, had the exhibit down at the Historical Society last year, and Joe was a great part of that exhibit. And we found out a lot about him. So we did know about him, but it's interesting to find out about Tom Rocky because he's been the forgotten half of that duo, and I'm glad that tonight we got a little chance to review his life.
Well, okay, now we get to the interesting part. The land has been donated, and all of you are very pleased. And now comes the hard work. How did it all begin up there, Dom?
Well, once we got the land, they named me chairman of construction, put the building up. We had $50 in our treasury at the time. So I scouted around, I got a set of plans from another building, come back, and we agreed to put up that building. We had another 18 feet to the building. And we started digging for the footing by hand. We had no equipment at the time, so I had the troops up there with picks and shovels, and we dug the footing. We got the footing in, then we got Ricky Patera, who at the time was foundation contractor. And he donated all his equipment. He set up all his equipment there, and he poured the concrete, and all we did was pay for the concrete.
Wow.
He put the foundation in for us.
Yeah. Did you tell me that the Vitale family went up there and bulldozed the land?
Oh, yeah, well, the Vitale family did all the back fill, backhoe and all that stuff.
Work.
In fact, they gave us the crane to put up the steel, too. They gave us all the equipment we needed to put up whatever we had to do.
I see.
Through the year.
Now, what time of the year was this begun? Was this in the summertime this was begun?
Yeah, we started in the summertime.
So you're working towards the winter months now, trying to put up
and we had to stop.
You just took the
stop.
Time for... And
we raised money in the winter.
Okay.
Okay. Shells and things
so
like
the
that.
Foundation is dug, and it's the next year.
Then we went for the loan.
Okay.
So we went for a $25,000 loan, and 13 of us signed the loan, and we had back it up.
Pledged your houses and everything else probably to make it...
It helped.
Yeah.
But at any rate, we got the first loan, $25,000, and we start putting up the building.
Yeah. Now, who would you get for workmen? I mean, you were telling me that a lot of the members had skills. They had union skills.
Yeah.
They volunteered there.
Tell them how we got the work then.
Well, we had a little small core of professionals.
Yeah.
That bricklayers, masons, and whatnot.
Yep.
And regardless of what our individual skills were, we all became bricklayers and masons and ditch diggers. And, people put a tool or an appliance in our hand, and we learned how to use it. Yeah. We literally did. And I used to carry a hod with mud for the bricklayers.
What were you most proficient at, Rocky? Do you remember?
I've done the same thing. I used to carry the cement up to the bricklayer that was putting the blocks down, and boy, I never see a fella put blocks down so fast. Yeah. I couldn't keep up with him with the cement.
That's right.
And then actually, we had masons, actual bricklayers, and who did the work. We had our professional people.
Oh yeah, they did the work, they taught us how to work with them.
Well, yeah, naturally. Yeah. But see, we used to work nights, and then when it got dark, used to quit.
Doing your day job 7 to 5, and then you having to get out of there, I'm sure, was wore you right out.
Rocky. Oh, yeah.
So one day I was fortunate enough to get some temporary lights.
Oh, boy.
And I set up the
temporary... The second shift begins.
Set up the temporary lights, and because every night that I would say, let's go, it's getting dark, let's move it. So then I told the guys I'm making cement, I said, make a couple more batches. It's too dark. I says, just make the batches, do what you're told. So as it got dark, because these masons now, they're going like hell. And so I turned on the lights, and I almost went crazy. So he had to work a couple more hours, and that's how he's...
Well, it's all for the cause, huh, Don? Yeah. Richard?
How long did it take to put the building together, basically?
It took over, I would say, 2.5 years, mm-hmm. at least, because we had that hurricane, I think it was 57.
Oh, yes.
I don't know what year it was.
56.
56, 56 I think, whatever. But it knocked down 3 of our walls.
Really? So you had to start over again?
It's not only start over again, we had to take all the concrete off of the blocks and broken
at that point, Rocky, I'm sure some of the guys are ready to throw the towel in, weren't they?
Yeah.
They couldn't.
Well, it was a setback, but we had to keep going.
Yeah.
Yeah, because we started it. We wanted to finish it.
Yeah.
Did you have insurance on that when that happened?
Insurance. We were lucky to pay
for the bricks.
Yes, lucky we could
That's
pay.
It. So you start right out from scratch.
Oh, yeah.
More money.
What was the first portion or section of the building to be completed, though?
Well, once the foundation was up, we put the basement floor in.
Okay.
And we put the floor in for the main hall, then we start up going up with the rest of the building.
Which brings us to Father Curtin at St. George Church.
Well, Father Curtin was assigned to start a new church in North Beverly. And his niece married Tommy Musumeci, who was one of our commanders at the time. So he was interested in starting this church right at our post. And I can tell you what they went through to go to Mass, because all they had was chairs. We sometimes had to go out there at 5 o'clock in the morning to push the water up, because and that's where they had the Mass, in the basement of the building. The building wasn't even, we just had didn't have the windows on the second floor down.
Oh.
Then when we had the second floor done, the church members come down and help us put the plywood down, and they moved upstairs, which was better quarters. Then I put some temporary heat in for her.
You mean they were down there without heat at the beginning?
Oh, no heat, no.
Oh, my goodness.
Heck, we didn't have anything. Didn't have windows.
They weren't there before we had electric power. Mm-hmm.
Rocky, you were saying you guys laid planks over the mud and water so the parishioners could get into the building?
That's right.
Jeez.
You got to give them...
It's like the Wild West days.
It is. I mean, I can see these temporary buildings in Dodge City.
Well, while Father Curtin was saying Mass, we'd be out there. We had our cement mixers going and everything, you know. They had to contend with that also. So he was competing with all the outside noises.
Yeah. Yeah. So do you consider this to be a plus to have had Father Curtin and his flock up there?
I think my personal opinion, I think we were blessed tenfold for doing that. I really believe that, because we've had... We get up every morning, thank God. Sometimes you just say, thank God, look how far we've come over the years. Somebody was on our side.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I really believe that.
It held up the work of the building, but we didn't mind, because we thought we were doing something good.
A good cause.
A good cause. So.
I asked you guys to think of the biggest challenge that you had to face during this period of time, and I think we've mentioned a few, the hurricane, et cetera. But I imagine, Rocky, keeping the enthusiasm up of the rank and file would be one of the big challenges that was to be overcome at that time. It was pretty easy to get discouraged after all that.
Well, it certainly was. You know, you took on a project that was so big, and you never dreamed that you could ever make it, and you did it, you built it, you reached your goal, and it was a great feeling.
Yeah.
And in the meantime, why, we used to worry about getting the money up to pay the rent every month to the bank.
Yeah. But you made the payments?
Well, we made it.
Over the long haul?
Yeah, there was a certain nucleus that was always working and keeping everything alive.
I understand, Tony, that this fellow here was kind of like the commanding general here. He kind of ran.
Well, General Ramrod would be the appropriate name, but you know, and not to embarrass Pepe, but we never, that building wouldn't exist today without him. He's really the man behind it all, and what he did, we were young adults in those days, and we were raising families, and we had kids, and a lot of us found ourselves having to work two jobs, you know, and we're trying to, you know, whatever, build our own personal lives up, and then we'd have, you know, our setbacks. The walls weren't the only setbacks we had there. We'd have a little setback here and a little setback there, and so that brings us to what Rocky's statements revealed, that you know, we started, some of us got discouraged, this and that. And there's a guy that kept us all together. And he was like the glue that bonded us all. And he used his own ways of keeping us together, but they worked. And you could be having supper with your wife and kids, and he'd drag you out of the house right up to work. But it worked. And we followed Pepe. And it's good leadership. He likes to use the word leadership. Well, he's a guy that sets the example, and that's how we did it.
Understanding wives, Dick, what'd you say?
Oh, yeah. I mean, every organization I've ever seen, first of all, you start out with a lot of folks, and everybody's all gung-ho, and they want to get something done. And then very shortly afterwards, they start to drop out, and you end up with, just as he said, a nucleus that keeps coming back and keeps it going. Yeah. And to do that, you need the support of the other half, the wives, the girlfriends, whatever, because if they don't let you out, that doesn't get done.
Yep. Well, our fine director out there in the control room, Stephen Pike, is going to take a camera, and we're going to go up to the post, and we're going to do a sweep. So why don't we, at this point in time, kind of visualize what it's like up there. We'll start with you, Rocky. Perhaps you could describe the top floor as it exists today of the building, the post, looking at it straight ahead from, let's say, on the other side of Brimble Avenue, and we're going to go up the front steps. What would we encounter as we go through there?
Well, as you enter the hall, the front steps, on the right was the coat room, and we had the ladies' room on the left, and you walked into the hall, and we had a small bar on your left-hand side, probably about 12 feet long, and the hall, I think, at the time, might have been, what, 40 by 80? Something.
Oh, I don't think 40. It was 80. No. It was
48 by 91.
48 by 91.
Originally?
Anyway, what we did
is... Oh, not the hall,
not the original.
Sorry.
Underneath the stage, we had a stage, and underneath the stage, we had plywood that we could remove and put storage underneath there. And then we... come to find out that we didn't have enough room for storage. So what we proposed is putting an addition onto the building, moving the stage back, and getting more storage room that way. So we did that, and we find we still don't have enough storage room. So after a while, I forgot what year we put on the addition on the side.
Well, that was the first addition, the one on the side.
Yeah. We put an addition on the side. We put a men's room in there, and a very nice bar, kitchen,
yep.
And Then after that, we moved the stage back in.
You have one of the finest floors up there, I think, in the whole city of Beverly, if not on the North Shore, for dancing and sociability, I think, up there. It's a marvelous place.
We used to have windows on the second floor, too, and the ladies' auxiliary used to pick out the curtains and put them decorate the windows, but eventually, after a while, we had to block them in.
Yeah. So, well, are we ready to get downstairs? Downstairs, yeah. Joe, Tony?
Okay. Well, downstairs we have you access the lounge, the downstairs section by either lounge door. There's one on immediately off the parking lot, and there's one down in the rear of the building. And that puts you into our function hall downstairs. But as you enter the generally used entrance on the side of the building, that takes you right into our lounge area, our lower lounge, we call it. And we have bar facilities there, and we have widescreen TV, and in fact, we have three TVs down there in that area, and we're set up for people's comfort and enjoyment, dart games, and there's dart contests and whatnot. And then we have, off the lounge, we have a pool room, which is off to the left side of the bar. And we have intercity, an intercity pool contests there. And our pool team travels throughout the North Shore. And so that they make good use of that room. And behind that room, we have a members, sort of like a caucus room, a meeting room for members or committee work and things like that. And then adjacent to those rooms, we'll be behind the bar area. Everything I'm describing now will fall behind the bar area. We have the commander's office sits way in the way off to the extreme side of the building, and as an anteroom to the commander's office, you have what we call our computer room, and we have our high-speed copier equipment, our paper folding machine, and our computer system, and we do all our publications, our flyers and whatnot there. And then getting back into the lounge as you head to the rear of the building. Oh yeah, then you walk through a kitchen, you come back to the immediate rear of the bar, and that's a full kitchen facility there for the, and that works with our lower hall, and for people that rent that for smaller weddings and anniversary parties and whatnot. And then that brings us to that lower hall. And we have a fireplace there, which is now a mock fireplace. But years before we put the addition on, it was a working fireplace. We used to use that. And it was kind of nice and homey there when we used that fireplace. But we don't have that anymore. And that's a very nice hall. And that floor is a tile floor, but that's well maintained. We have to give credit to our maintenance crew up there. Yeah. They do, as you said, they do a marvelous job with that floor upstairs, and they do just as good a job as with the floors downstairs. Mm-hmm. And all in all, we have a pretty comprehensive building there, and we can about meet anybody's needs there.
Now, have you expanded as much as you intend to at this point in time?
I hope so.
This is it. Huh?
We've made two major additions in that building over the years.
Just briefly mention that Fine Eagle Award, because I would like our viewers to see that beautiful.
Well, that Eagle, we have an Eagle Award that it was custom made actually for us. That was given to us by the director of the Bedford VA hospital, and in recognition of what we've done for veterans, disabled and hospitalized veterans over the years. And they gave us an Eagle Award, which they've only given two out, and they do not duplicate that award to any one recipient. So what they did, they wanted to show us some public recognition, so they came up with this new award. Yeah. And it's a beautiful crystal eagle on a piece of genuine briar. And I hope you can show it on
it's
this.
It's a showpiece, yeah.
We have because it on the screen you have to down. See that to appreciate it. Yeah. And we're very proud of that. That's one of the highlights of our existence, receiving that award.
Dick, you want to add anything before we push along here?
I just want to say that when I first went in there to a high school reunion about 10 years ago, I'd never been in the building before, and I was just absolutely blown away by the facility. It's just beautiful inside the main hall. As Ted said, it's just a wonderful piece of work. Yeah. Should be very proud of it.
Yeah. Now, Dom, we mentioned the organization of the post. You of course are the local chapter, the local group. You have a state group and a national group above you. Can you mention?
Yes, we have a national and a state.
Yeah.
State department and national department.
Yeah. Can you briefly just distinguish the responsibilities between the upper and the lower levels?
It's like all veterans group. You have a national organization, then you have every national have certain state departments.
Yeah.
And we're just a post of the state of Massachusetts department, yeah. Although we're affiliated with the national.
Yeah. And you mentioned, I think, that the national group does a bit of politicking on behalf of the veterans there. They're down at talking to Congress, et cetera.
That's their primary thing, yeah. Is the lobby.
Yeah. I wanted to ask you about the women now. From the very beginning, the women have been involved, Rocky, have they not, with the post?
Yes, we had a ladies' auxiliary, and when we started.
Very helpful.
But, yeah, they were...
In fact, they were the backbone of the post, if you want to know the truth.
Yeah.
They did all every party we had, every function we had, they did all the cooking, made all the sandwiches. Yeah.
They made the curtains.
Raised money.
Were these veterans themselves, or were they the wives of the veterans?
They were the wives. Yeah. We had two women who were chartered members of our post.
Yep. Okay. Richard?
Do you still have women involved, or is it more or less unofficial at this point?
No, we still have women involved. In fact, our judge advocate is a woman.
Okay.
Just a brief word about the affiliation between you and all of the other posts in Beverly. I know there's the Spear Post 331 on Judson Street, the Waddell Post, the Carnegie Post, Beverly Farms. You guys all work together on certain projects and on certain occasions. Do you not, Tony?
Yeah, yes, we do. We have one thing. Beverly's lucky. All the veterans posts of Beverly have an extremely good relationship with one another. I remember there was a veteran died last year, and we were asked to furnish honor casket guards, if you will.
Yep.
So we call up some of the other veterans posts because oftentimes you'll have a member that's also a member of other veterans groups also.
Yep.
So as a courtesy, we got the word out to the other veterans post that we were making this arrangement at the request of the family. These guys, they come down, you know, like they come down on a jet plane. They kind of get there quick enough to cooperate. And I think, in a nutshell, that's about the way it works.
Yep.
We have very good relationships.
And you all come under the umbrella of the Veterans Agency
Veterans Council
down on Dade Street.
Right. All the posts have representation at the Veterans Council. And that's how we keep in contact with each post. And whatever they do with Veterans Day or anything like that, we all participate with the Veterans Committee.
A lot of guys, Rocky, belong to more than one post, too, I'm sure, right?
Oh, I'm sure there is, yes. Yeah.
Because I think Jake told me he belongs to the Spear Post as well as the,
organization. He belongs to the Vietnam Vets Post, too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's talk. We're getting low on time here, Dick, but I want to get into the pancake breakfast.
Mm-hmm. I went to one of those for the first time about a month and a half ago. I mean, you see the sign out there every month. You drive by and say, I got to go to one of those sometime. And I never did. And finally, my wife got up one morning on a Sunday. And she says, you want to go out to eat? I said, okay. And I happen to remember I'd seen the sign the day before. I says, I know where we're going. So we went up there, and it was just fabulous. We had a great time. They put out a fantastic breakfast. Obviously, you have a cadre of people that work at this thing. Can you describe a little bit of that for us?
Yeah, we have a crew... pretty much the same people. In fact, one of your people here, Steve, has
Steve
been working
Pike.
With us on that. He's a newer member of it.
He's working his way up through.
Well, when the younger ones come in like that, Jake is officially names them as members of the diaper brigade. That's what. And anyway, I'm going to tell you right now, the average age working in that kitchen, and it's a lot of hard work, is I'd say 68, 69 years old.
As much work as goes into this now, the money that comes from this, what does that go toward?
The money, the proceeds, every month we usually sponsor some local group, usually mm-hmm. some local youth group, you know, drum corps or a football team or a basketball or whatever. Mm-hmm. And so a portion of that proceeds goes to that youth group that we sponsor.
Okay.
And the remainder goes to our Veterans Aid Fund, which okay. most of that money gets funneled to support the programs at Bedford VA Hospital, Jamaica Place, yeah. West Roxbury.
1981, the organization was opened up to all veterans. Prior to that, it was
became
for,
congressionally
yeah.
Recognized,
yeah.
which meant that we could open up to every nationality.
Which really increased your membership role tremendously
yes,
at that
it
point
doubled.
In time.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What are the fees, if any, to join?
Well, in our post, we only charge $20 a year dues. It varies from the local organization, throughout the local organization. We charge $20 a year.
Yeah, and for that, they have full access to the building,
cocktail
lounge.
They have all the rights of a member.
Yeah. And I understand there's Friday night, Saturday night socials that people right. partake in. Yeah. And you really do have to be a member, though, Rocky, to go there. You just don't come in off the street for a glass of beer. You have to be
a member.
Well, technically yeah. speaking, some of our socials, you don't have to be a member. The only time you have to be a member.
No, we're talking to going in.
Or going
to the
into the building.
Yeah, but we do have a limited membership. Lounge membership.
Yeah, it works well.
That works very well.
Yeah. yeah. Okay. Again, we're just about at our time here now. But the greatest, I think, achievements that you guys perhaps could come up with. You mentioned outstanding leadership and outstanding membership. Now, have I covered the bases here in terms of, I think. What I'm trying to get at in terms of how you people see the club, how you have, after all these 50 years, have looking back on those times, that the membership and along with the leadership have really made it what it is today.
No question about it.
Fair statement.
No question about it.
Yeah.
I agree with that.
Yeah. Rocky, you'd go along with that?
Oh yeah, definitely. Yes. Okay. Yeah, and I'm proud of what we do for the veterans.
Yep.
And the community.
Yeah, and the community. And
a lot of which goes unknown, and we won't go into that, mm-hmm. but I know that you guys do a lot of work that people just aren't aware of, and that's the way it is, you know. Dick, any last comment here before we close it up?
Yeah, as we are fighting our way through the unpleasantness in Afghanistan right now, I see perhaps a new source of veterans in the future, which will build your membership roles. Are you thinking about that as time goes on?
Well, We took care of that problem. Our post submitted 3 years ago a change of bylaws that anybody in the armed forces could join. Mm-hmm. And we felt that anybody who was in the service was giving up not only their time, but their sacrifice in their life, because even peacetime we had a lot of casualties. So
that's
how we already changed our.
And of course the Vietnam fellows are coming in there now and they're doing things that you
their kids have grown up and they're getting them through college and they're starting to show up. And we need somebody to turn this thing over to.
Absolutely.
Makes you feel old, Rocky, doesn't it?
You tell me.
Unfortunately, we are out of time here. We've run a little over time. I want to thank Dick Symmes. I want to thank Dominic Carnevale and Tony Dettorre and Rocky Pizziaro for their kindness in coming in tonight. And the Vittori-Rocci place is one of Beverly's finest. It's a show place, really.
It really is.
People of Beverly to enjoy.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, fellas.
Thank you.
Ed Joseph, thank you for watching, ladies and gentlemen, and we'll see you a little later on. Good night for now.